Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Lutheran Church of the Lakes on this Advent Sunday. And it is still Advent, and so we hear a lot in this season about John the Baptist, who went out baptizing the Jordan River. And we get Luke's account of John the Baptist today. And I noticed something. I was listening to someone much smarter than I talk about it, and they pointed out something in the Luke version that I never noticed. That he is calling everyone, even the people there to be baptized, right? Here's John's famous line, "You brood of vipers." Well, that kind of hurts. So let's talk about what that means for us and who we are as children of God. But if you would please stand and join me, we begin our service in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Let us then confess our sins to God our Father.
Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your presence. Son Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all of your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
words.
Prepare the way of the Lord. Make his path straight.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Comfort and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth.
Thank you. readings from the first chapter of Philippians. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God in all my remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine, for you all making my prayer with joy. Because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. And I'm sure of this, that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. It is right for me to feel this way about you all, because I hold you in my heart, for you are all partakers with me of grace, both in my imprisonment and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel. For God is my witness, how I yearn for you all with the affection of Jesus Christ Jesus. And it is my prayer that your love may abound more and more with knowledge and all discernment, so that you may approve what is excellent, and so be pure and blameless for the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ, to the glory and praise of God. I want you to know, brothers, that what has happened to me has really served to advance the gospel. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the reading of the gospel. John, the son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. And he went into all the region around the Jordan, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. As it is written in the book of the words of Isaiah the prophet, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Every valley shall be filled, and every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall become straight, and the rough places shall become level ways. And all flesh shall see the salvation of God. He said, therefore, to the crowds that came out to be baptized by him, you brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bear fruits in keeping with repentance, and do not begin to say to yourselves, we have Abraham as our father. For I tell you, God is able from these stones to raise up children from Abraham. Even now the axe is laid to the root of the trees. Every tree, therefore, that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. And the crowds asked him, what then shall we do? And he answered them, whoever has two tunics is to share with him who has none, and whoever has food is to do likewise. Tax collectors also came to be baptized and said to him, teacher, what shall we do? And he said to them, collect no more than you are authorized to do. Soldiers also asked him, what shall we do? And he said to them, do not extort money from anyone by threats or by false accusation, and be content with your wages. This is the gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. Thank you. Christ. I'm not a big fan of Disney movies. I know, Heidi knows too, and she hates it too. I'm just a Scrooge for them. I'm not a big fan of Snow White. I don't get the Disney princess thing, but recently, and yes, I know we're even years behind on this one, but we saw Moana. I don't know if any of you have had the opportunity. It's a fairly new Disney movie, and I liked it a lot, actually. I don't know if it just had Dwayne The Rock Johnson, you know, a wrestling legend in it, or what made it so enjoyable. But I remember having a conversation a few years ago with Professor Ben Hout. He loves movies. He's one of these professors we'd hang out with, and they would just talk about movies. Well, he told us at the SEM about Moana. And he described it this way. He said it's a coming-of-age story about a young princess, or rather the chief's daughter, in the Fiji Islands, with great music and adventure, as Moana, the heroine, follows her call to save the world from destruction. So she goes on her adventure. She gains allies and friends along the way, including a goofy chicken, and confronts the big bad at the end of the movie. And of course, just when things are most dire and she is in the clutches of the big bad, and the big bad is being big and bad and covered in lava, Moana switches things. She looks at the evil monster, stares at her lovingly, and says, "Listen to the voice within you. You are still good." And the lava hardens. The big bad becomes the giant good, and the world is saved. It's a repentance of sorts, and of course, all ends well. Well, I knew much more about a different series, but a similar concept, Star Wars. I'm thinking when Luke knows that this is not the moment where I am your father, and he yells no, he's reconciled it. He's walking with Darth Vader, and he tells his father, "There's still good inside of you. It has not been driven from you completely." It's a common trope in cinema, a thing we see often for characters to be going one direction, but to have that spark left in them of goodness deep in their hearts. And all it takes is for them to look deeper into their hearts, to see who they really are. Well, I want to ask you this same question. I want us to do some self-reflection. Advent is the series of reflection, a series where we are called to prepare and where we are even called to repent. Because our Holy King is coming. This is also the season where we cry out, "Come, Lord, come quickly." And in Aramaic, the original language, we say, "Maranatha, come quickly, Lord." So my question to you and to me is, are you ready to stare Jesus in the eyes and give an account for your life? Our text today in Luke 3 helps us to do that. It's the story of John the Baptizer, the one who is not a Baptist because he goes to the Baptist church, but he's out there baptizing people over and over. And you probably know something of John, if not a lot about John. There's, of course, his classic line, "You brood of vipers." I think it's funny. We, at the end of our school year at the seminary, over time at the seminary, we actually pick people, you know, based on goofy awards. So I was second in line to use "brood of vipers" in a sermon. My friend won, but I won't hold it against him. It's a famous line, and to hear "you brood of vipers," there's nothing that it can do to your heart except smack you in the feels, as we say. It hurts. So what does it mean? It means you're the offspring of Satan, is what John is saying. Now, I always have thought of the Matthew recalling of this event, when it is very specific that John is saying, "You brood of vipers," to tax collectors, Pharisees, and Sadducees. These overly religious hypocrites, of course they are offspring of snakes, I think. Not so in Luke. Luke says that there were many people in the audience. It wasn't just the descendants of Abraham who can claim purity from descent. No, John was speaking to, as Isaiah says, all flesh. And so he addresses his brood of vipers statement to the people who were there to be baptized, the ones who were coming seeking the Lord and forgiveness. It was written in Isaiah that all shall see the salvation of God. So it is to all flesh that John addresses brood of vipers. It's not just the priest under Caiaphas, and it's not just those under the Roman Emperor Tiberius Caesar, but all flesh, which is so much wider than that. John was calling everyone alive to repentance at that time. So if we are descended from someone who was alive at that time, which I believe we all are, then you and I are all brood of vipers. Or rather, we were. No longer. At one point, we were descended from the serpent Satan. Spawn of Satan is what John is calling the world, each and every one of us. John will never be a Disney princess, even though he joins them in saying, look inside yourself. But when we look inside ourselves, if there is not Jesus, we see something entirely different. So he says, you brood of vipers. And yet you people, you dear people of God, you are baptized with repentance. You are baptized for the forgiveness of sins. You are baptized with Jesus into his baptism, and he dwells in you. Look inside yourself, and what do you see? You are Christ. He is within you, and you have been filled with his Holy Spirit. No longer are you descendants of evil. No longer are we unfruitful trees waiting to be chopped down. Instead, you have the fruit of the Spirit which pours out of you. You are reborn in that saving water of baptism and of repentance. Yours is the death of Christ. It's the forgiveness of sins in him. Yours is the resurrection of Jesus for your justification. Not because in you was hope, but because hope was put into you. This promise is yours. But it's not only yours. We see the quote from Isaiah, and it's Advent, so it shows up everywhere. There is a voice in the wilderness crying out. We have that check. There is going to be a godly-sized renovation of the mountains and the valleys and the paths. Check. But that last line, all flesh shall see the salvation of God. Not a little bit of flesh, all flesh. This message to look inside you and to see Jesus rather than Satan is not just for you, it is for the world. We have this life of repentance. We have a life that has been granted to bear good fruit. What does this life look like? Well, first John offers a universal call to repentance. That is the life that bears good fruit. Then he says, if you have more clothes than you need, share them. If you have more food than you need, share it. But then John gets specific, right? The tax collectors are the next saying, well, what about us, John? And John says, be honest, tax collectors, with your collection. And then the soldiers say, what about us? Be honest. Don't extort money. Be fair. What we see is that the life of repentance, of a fruitful tree, of a person filled with Christ, looks different depending on our station, depending on our job, depending on the family that God has granted us. Not everyone will live the life of repentance as a pastor. Not everyone will live the life of repentance as a parent. Not everyone will live the same life of repentance. God has granted us different roles in which to live the life that bears good fruit. And most of it is simplified as this. Give grace. Simply give grace. Give grace to your spouse. Give grace to your family. Give grace to your pastor. Give grace to your brothers and sisters here. And especially give grace to the world that doesn't yet know of God's grace. The Holy Spirit has called us and enabled us to give grace. It means we don't seek the gotcha moments when someone sins. It means we don't hold things against one another. Instead, we forgive and release it. We don't withhold forgiveness from those that come saying, "I repent." And we don't use another's failure as leverage. We give grace. By doing that, our relationships and our fruit will blossom. Because in grace, there is forgiveness. The same grace that we are about to pray, "God, forgive us," as we forgive others. So that when Jesus comes, and we meet him, and we rejoice, and we stand there, and he will ask, "What have you done with all that I have given you?" We will be able to not say to his face, "I am so good, I am so awesome, Lord, look at all that I have done." Instead, we will say, "Lord, I was brood of vipers, and you saved me. Lord, I looked inside myself, and I saw you. I am your child, a child of God, not a child of serpents. I am baptized into forgiveness, and my life is one of repentance, for I have your Holy Spirit. Jesus, my life is in you. I've borne good fruit as I could. I've served my neighbor in love as able, and I ask all else, Lord, to forgive me." I pray that God would keep you his child through all time, so that we can see him face to face. Amen. If you would please stand and join me as we confess our faith in that good and gracious Lord. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated as we return our gifts to the Lord. Thank you. saved us. If you were to ask us to look inside our hearts, and without Jesus we would see nothing good. Oh, with you, Lord, we see the ultimate good dwelling within us with the promise that you will be with us forever. Lord, thank you. Thank you for helping us to bear good fruit, for helping us to repent, to call others into love, and to show others the joy that we have in you. So Lord, thank you, and help us to share that word that others may know and be with you, so that on the last day, when every person meets your Son face to face, they would join us in saying, Lord, you have forgiven me. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And Father, we pray for those who are hurting and healing. We ask that you would continue the healing for Donna Klinger, Sonia Merrill, Derek Bias and Molly Schmitz, for Jerry Dart and Bud LeCoe, and also for Chris, Denny DeMuth's daughter. We ask that you will be with people who are preparing for surgery, that it would be successful and a quick recovery, including for Ellen and Bob and others. Lord, grant all these people great treatment, quick healing, and your presence throughout everything. Lord, in your mercy. And Father, we ask you to be with all of your saints around the world whom you have forgiven, that you would make all of us abundant trees with much fruit. Protect all of those who are in danger, all of your Christian children, but also grant us a good harvest here, Lord, as we seek to interact with the people we know and to show them your love. We pray also for other churches in our district here in Michigan, including Calvary, Family of Christ, St. John's, St. Paul Community, and St. Thomas Lutheran churches around the state. We pray also for our nation, Lord, that you would bless and protect those serving in our armed forces. Please guide and direct all of our elected and appointed officials and leaders, including President Donald Trump. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Lord, we pray that you would keep us in faith, and that your Son would continue to teach us to pray to you. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.